Hello dear learners, my dear students, myself Deenadayalan K, head of the Department of Biology from AC Independent PUC College. In this video, we are going to study a part of the chapter 13, that is Organisms and Population from Ecology. Our living world is fascinatingly diverse and amazingly complex. We can try to understand its complexity by investigating the processes at various levels of biological organizations that I am going to talk about. At any level of biological organization, we can ask two types of questions. For example, when we hear the bulbul singing early morning in the garden, we may raise two types of questions. How does the bird sing? Or why does the bird sing? The how type of questions seek the mechanism behind the process, while the why type of questions seek the significance of the process. For the first question in our example, which is highlighted here, the answer might be in terms of the operation of the voice box and the vibrating bone in the birds. The voice box, it is called a syrinx in case of birds. Whereas the second question, the answer may lie in the bird's need to communicate with its mate during the breeding season. When we observe the nature around us with the scientific frame of mind, it will certainly come up with many interesting questions of both the types. To mention few, like why are the night blooming flowers generally white? How does the bee know which flower has nectar? Why does cactus have so many thorns? Actually, it is not thorns, it is the modified leaves to check the rate of transpiration in case of xerophytic plants like opuntia, that is so called cactus. It is called modified leaf spines, not thorns. How does the chick recognize her own mother? And still so many questions. Now we will study the definition of ecology. The term ecology was first coined by a German scientist, Ernst Haeckel, in 1866. Ecology is a branch of biology that deals with the interactions between the organisms, that is, biotic factors, and its physical environment, that is, the abiotic factors. The living organisms are included under biotic factors, and the non-living factors are called abiotic factors, like light, temperature, soil, salinity, water, etc. Study of ecology is important to strike a balance between both the development and the maintenance of natural, environmental and biotic communities, use and conservation of resources to solve local, regional and global environmental problems. Ecology is basically concerned with four different levels of organizations, such as organisms, populations, communities and finally the biomes. Ecological hierarchy. It is considered as the one of the ecological level of organization that is connected with the ecological grouping of organisms. And next we have here a flowchart containing the various levels of biological organization. Firstly, the individual, that is single organism present in a given habitat, that is the dwelling place, is considered. Many such organisms, that is the individuals of the same species in a given area, forms the population, the second one. And next to that population, the arrow mark, the biotic community, where various kinds of populations are included. This biotic community of various kinds, community of organisms, forms together an ecosystem that lead to various ecosystems in a landscape, and in the landscape together of different types forms the biome, and the biome in the biosphere. To understand very clearly, we'll take one more part here. The levels of biological organization, you can see very clearly here, from the atomic level to the biosphere level. You all can understand very easily this diagrammatic sketch, because you are all aware of the chemistry aspects of this. Atoms together in various forms form the molecules, like if you considered helium, it is an atom, N, nitrogen, O, oxygen, like that. When these occurs either diatomic or triatomic, like O2, N2, H2, like that, it forms the molecules. Different molecules together forms the micromolecules in various chemical combinations. These micromolecules forms the macromolecules like carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, the nucleic acids such as RNA, DNA, etc. And some of these proteins may act as enzymes and may facilitate the process of the chemical reactions, like cellular activities, that you are going to study in another chapter, that is origin of life. And it will form together the organelles, like a nucleus, mitochondria, chloroplasts in plants, centrioles in animal cells, like that. And it will form the cells. And the cell which is having the good organization inside it, many similar cells together forms the tissues, like parenchyma, colenchyma, sclerenchyma, or even in animals, epithelial tissue, connective tissues, etc., like that. Various tissues together form organs. Organs together forms organ system. Organ system forms the well-organized organism. Many similar organisms in a given area forms a population. Different populations in a given area interacting with each other forms the community. Various community of organisms interacting with the abiotic factors form the ecosystem. Ecosystems of various kinds with the different habitats forms the biomes. The larger biomes together forms the biosphere, and the biosphere, it's in the, that is the globe Earth itself, and it is in the solar system in our galaxy, that is Milky Way, and so on. Hope you all have understood this introductory part, which you are studying from the lower classes. Now, under organisms and its environment, we'll study about the environment. The sum total of all the biotic and abiotic factors, already I have mentioned, biotic factors refers to the living organisms. It may be from the unicellular amoeba, protozoans, and till the multicellular highly organized mammals, and also from plants, lower blue-green algae, unicellular filamentous, up to the highly advanced groups of plants, that is monocots. Abiotic factors we are going to study further, that is non-living factors. the sum total of all the biotic and abiotic factors, the substances and the conditions that surround and potentially is going to influence the organisms without becoming their constituent part is called environment. At the organisms level, physiological ecology tries to understand how different organisms are adapted to their environment in terms of survival and the reproduction. Physiological ecology means what is the nature of the internal condition of the organism in maintaining body temperature or pH of the blood or anything like that, inorganic factors and fluid condition, everything internally, that is the homeostatic factors. The variation in the intensity and the duration of the temperature, along with the annual variations in precipitation, that is rainfall, results in the formation of major biomes like desert, rainforest and tundra. Here we are going to see a picture showing the distribution of various biomes, mainly with respect to the temperature annually and also the rainfall, that is precipitation. Based on that, we have here the desert biomes, grassland biomes, tropical forest biomes, temperate forest biomes, coniferous forest biomes. Coniferous, the name itself indicates the cone-like trees. For example, the gymnosperms mostly like Christmas tree. Very easily you can understand. Arctic and alpine tundra biomes. And to understand further, there is a flowchart here which highlights the major biomes of the world and also our country. Major biomes of the world are desert biomes, grassland biomes, Arctic and alpine tundra, coniferous forest, temperate forest, tropical forest. And the major biomes in our country are categorized into four types: tropical rainforest, deciduous forest biome, desert biomes and sea coasts. There will be regional and local variations within each biome that lead to the formation of various kinds of habitats like tropical rainforest, deciduous forest, deserts and sea coasts, just now which you have studied under the flowchart too. The habitat refers to the dwelling place where the organism lives. For example, fish lives in water and earthworms lives in burrows, ant lives in burrows, and birds, arboreal habitat, that is the trees, and all the other organisms are on the land, and some are endophytes like blue-green algae like nostoc, which is living within the cortex of some plants like cycas roots, that is symbiotic in association. The habitat includes biotic components like pathogenic, that is disease causing organisms, parasites which may be either living on the organisms like a leech, blood sucking type, or inside the organisms like some pathogenic microorganisms or for example platyhelminthes, liver fluke, etc. Predators and competitors of the organisms with which they interact constantly. Next, there are four different major abiotic factors included here. First one, temperature. Second one, water. Third one, light. And the fourth one, soil. These are the four major factors which we are going to study here. Firstly, with respect to the temperature. Temperature is one of the most vital ecological factor that determines biomass of a place. What is biomass? The total dry weight of the organisms without moisture. For example, when you burn a plant after uprooting it along with the roots, whatever the ash you get, that is called the biomass, without including the water content or the moisture. The average temperature on land varies seasonally and decreases progressively from the equatorial zone towards the polar regions, from the plains to the mountain tops, and the temperature affects the kinetics of the enzymes, means the enzymes which are active at a specific temperatures. Like in first PUC you have studied digestive enzymes, like salivary amylase, which is functional at a slightly acidic environment like 6.8, and that is the pH, and other enzymes like pepsin, renin and all, it will be active only at the very least value of the pH, that is acidic pH, that is 1.2 to 1.5 or 2 pH value. And also it controls the basal metabolic rate, normal metabolic activities that is necessary or that is going on within the living cells of the organisms, that is very much needed to maintain the homeostatic condition, constant internal environment, along with the other physiological functions of the organisms. Other physiological functions means like respiration in on the organisms, photosynthesis in case of plants, synthesis of proteins, synthesis of lipids, synthesis of amino acids, enzymes, hormones, and its transportation to the region where there is a target organs, etc. Next, very important for 2 marks in the examination, very commonly asked, that is organisms types based on whether they live with tolerating the wide range of temperature or the narrow range of temperature. Eurythermal and stenothermal organisms, most commonly asked for 2 marks. The organisms that can tolerate wide range of temperatures are called eurythermal organisms. Means if there is slight change in the temperature also in the environment, they can manage to live. They will survive. Like cats, dogs, tigers, wild animals, etc. The organisms which have the ability to tolerate only the narrow range of temperatures are considered as stenothermal organisms. For example, like penguin, it can live only in the polar regions. When you bring penguin to the Bangalore climate and all, it won't be able to survive for a longer duration because it is adapted to live only in the narrow range of cold temperature existing in the polar regions. Likewise, fishes and crocodile, etc. A very important part for 2 marks or sometime 1 mark with example. Next, we have another second important factor, water. Life without water on the earth is highly unsustainable, unbelievable also. Because for the first time, the coesurvates, the so-called the living characters like replication of DNA was shown by the first formed eubions on the earth. It was in water only. Productivity and distribution of the plants is heavily dependent on water. For aquatic organisms, that is the organisms living in water, the quality of water, that is like chemical composition, the pH, the minerals dissolved in it, all this becomes very important. The salt concentration, it is called salinity, that is in measured in parts per thousand. It is less than 5 in inland waters, around 30 to 35 in the seawater, and in some hypersaline lagoons it may be more than 100. Based on whether the organisms are going to tolerate the wide range of salt concentration in the given aquatic environment or narrow range, it is classified into two types. The organisms that can tolerate the wide range of salinities are called urehaline. Halo means what? Salinity. Urehaline organisms such as salmon fish and herring, etc. The organism which have the ability to tolerate only the narrow range of salinities are called stenohaline organisms. For example, goldfish, which is a freshwater one, and haddock, that is a marine water one. This is also very important for 2 marks or 1 mark, the definitions in the part 1. Or 3 marks, what is urehaline and stenohaline organisms with examples. Next, here we have the another very important factor, light. Plants prepare their food materials by the process of protein synthesis only in the presence of sunlight, provided other factors like chlorophyll, leaf anatomy, and mainly water from the soil, carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, all these are necessary. Here we are going to highlight only the importance of light on the living organisms with respect to interaction. Some plants are adapted to low light conditions because they are overshadowed by tall canopied trees. You have studied last year the bryophytes. Usually they prefer to grow in the cold and shady regions. And flowering in some plants occurs only in the presence of the critical daylight called photoperiodism, that is the duration of the light which is going to control the process of flowering in the plants. And in first year you have studied the effect of light duration on the plants flowering process is called photoperiodism, and based on that also you have studied 3 kinds of plants: short day plants, long day plants, day neutral plants, etc. The availability of light and land is closely linked to that of the temperature, as the sun is the main and ultimate source of energy for both. The UV component of the sunlight is harmful to the plants and animals, thus we have a ozone layer to protect the earth from this harmful UV rays. And based on the organisms, whether they preferably choose to live in the presence of light or not, we can categorize the organisms into diurnal, nocturnal organisms. And this is very common from primary schools you have been studying. Diurnal means the organisms which are active during daytime, like most of the mammals including human beings. Nocturnal, like cockroaches and bed bugs and glowworms, during night they'll be very active. And final factor is the soil. The types of soil depends upon climate, weathering process. The process of formation of soil is called weathering. Whether the soil is transported or sedimentary, and how soil development occurs. Soil composition, that is chemical composition of the soil, based on that, you know, you are studied in geography in your high schools, like red soil, black cotton soil, etc. And the grain size, that is the soil particle size, and like stones, gravels, and further small grains are present, like in sand particles and all. And aggregation of these. In case of clay and all, the particles of soil are very compactly placed without any space in between. And in case of the sand, it is found in the form of grains. And it's going to determine the percolation and water holding capacity. Percolation means if you find the sand, for example, if you take in a pot sand filled with it and pour water in it, and a small hole will be there in the pot at the bottom, and the water percolates most of it and comes out because the space between the grains is larger. Whereas in case of clay, the space between the grains are very, very minute or no space. That's why we'll use the clay for making the pots with other various other chemical composition. Water holding capacity of the soil also varies. And you know, just now I gave examples to highlight the difference between the clay soil and the sandy soil. And that's going to explain the water holding capacity of the soil along with the pH of the soil, minerals that is present in the soil. That's going to be a very important factor for plants that is absorbed along with the water during ascent of sap, and it is used for the process of that is a physiological processes within it. And also this, along with minerals, the composition, the kind of minerals and topography also determines the vegetation in a given area. Topographical means the kind of soil which is present with the various shapes, grains and all that. It's going to decide the kind of plants and animals that is going to survive, live there, grow there. And the soil is going to support the kind of plants of its own choice, that they are, which are adapted in that area. Hope today we'll end up with the various abiotic factors and its effect on the organisms. In the next video, we'll study the details of responses of the organisms to these various abiotic factors and its change, and also how these organisms are adapted to the various environments. Dear students, please note all these. Any kind of clarifications you can note down and get it clarified once the class starts regularly after the breakdown of the lockdown. Stay at home along with that entertainment. Please do concentrate on the